Thank you. Architect Shilpa Jain Balwali from Studio Auspices. She needs no introduction. She's been at the helm of some amazing designs and she's extremely versatile. Thank you for being here with us today, Shilpa. We're looking forward to some great inputs from you. And last but not the least, we've got interior designer Rishi Raj Khare joining us all the way from Bilaspur. Rishi sir, welcome to the platform. We are so looking forward to getting some amazing design and style inputs from you.
Thank you. And nice to have you all here. Thank you.
So, like we know, today we are discussing the art of the smart. Before we move on with our topic, let me tell you, this is the EDIO's Design Devils. Now, you might ask, why Design Devils when I have such perfectly decent, you know, sweet, innocent, workaholic-looking people on my panel, okay? It is not about how they look, audience. It is about what they do. And you can see Prashant is already doing it there. I was also very tempted to put on, you know, one of those horn hair bands today. I thought...
The devil ears.
Yeah. No, I'm basically a rhinoceros. So I'll put one.
Okay, sir, that is very creative. I think we will take it into consideration. We have a devil rhinoceros. Okay, yes. So you've got one red horn there. We are completely with you, sir, on this one. You know, I love the idea of it. Okay, so when we talk about the design devils and we talk about topic like art of the smart, hum karne ki koshish kya kar rahe? Hum kuch karne ki koshish nahi kar rahe. Hum aapko ye batane ki koshish kar rahe ki aapko kya karna chahiye. So, dear audience, whoever's joining us and whoever's watching this webinar, let me tell you that all these designers here with me today are here to tell you what the future predicts and what you should have learned, what should have been the crux of interior design as you know it and understand it, and what is going to be paving the way forward for you. So, moving ahead with our conversation, today we'll start with the topic of the five essential factors of excellence in interior design. Rishi sir, ये तो हम आपसे शुरू करेंगे. Excellence of essential factors for interior design sir. आपको क्या लगता है sir?
Excellence factors.
जी sir.
ये बड़ा tough question है. Actually हर आदमी का अपना अपना perception है designs के ऊपर में. इसको explain करना थोड़ा सा मेरे लिए टफ इसलिए होता है एक्सेलेंस डिजाइन फैक्टर्स में कि कैसे आप आई एम इनटू विला डिजाइन दैट्स ऑल आई एम ओनली इनटू विला डिजाइन तो आई हैव अ फिक्स्ड थिंग ऑफ डिजाइनिंग मेरे विला जो मल्टीडिसिप्लिनरी वर्क करते हैं दे कैन एक्सप्लेन वेरी वेल अबाउट दिस एक्सेलेंस इन फैक्टर ऑफ डिजाइन तो पहले किसी उनसे स्टार्ट करिए फिर मैं आपको बताता हूँ कि विला में कैसे कन्वर्ट करते हैं
जी बिल्कुल सर प्रशांत वुड यू लाइक टू टेक दिस फॉरवर्ड व्हेन वी लुक एट एसेंशियल फैक्टर्स फॉर एक्सीलेंस इन इंटीरियर डिजाइन
एब्सोल्युटली आई थिंक एनी स्पेस स्टार्ट्स विद नंबर 1 द क्लाइंट बिकॉज़ फ्रैंकली अ क्लाइंट डज नॉट नीड एन आर्किटेक्ट टिल द टाइम ही डज नॉट वांट अ वैल्यू एडिशन इन द प्रोजेक्ट because otherwise I mean every client today has an access to say Pinterest or Google or thousands of YouTube videos thousands of internet images and everything and vendors are all available you just walk into the market and you know that wallpaper hai ya kya how to do it that is going to be defining your personality so I personally feel that interiors always begins with personality that why do I want a house which is different from somebody else or which is or office which is different from somebody else that is where the game starts and that is where the value addition starts of architects and interior designers otherwise I mean the market is open and you're free to kind of just go your own way do things on your own absolutely fine but to know what is going to go well with what how like for example every client doesn't know what he wants I mean just look at us we as customers 10 years back did not know that we wanted an iPhone it is still the time an iPhone was innovated by somebody and that is when it was infused into us that iPhone is an essential need for us I mean today frankly in this time if you don't have a phone you can actually go under depression maybe. I'm assuming a lot of people would think about that because you're kind of so into it now. And
correct.
10 years back, you did not have that as a necessity or as a need. So a customer doesn't know what he wants until and unless you provide him that value addition, that solution, that this is what you need. And this is all tailor-made after studying or understanding your company's personality or your home or your family's personality. And that is what is, so I personally feel it's talking about the personality.
Okay.
So I have one question with you. 90% client to aajkal khud se banwai lete, just hire interior designer just to show people that we have hired some big names for my to design my house. और आर्किटेक्ट्स एंड डिजाइनर्स को मैंने देखा भी है कि वो उनके साथ ही मूव आउट करते हैं, कभी भी उनको समझाने का, क्योंकि एक प्रोजेक्ट जाने का डर है उनके मन से, वो क्या करते हैं, उन्हीं के साथ में उन्हीं के वे में फ्लो आउट कर जाते हैं। तो हम लोग को समझाने के लिए जब हम डिजाइंस के बारे में उनको समझाते हैं तो वो हमको अलग कर देंगे, ज़्यादा आप उनको समझाओगे तो अलग कर देंगे। तो आप उस मैटर को कैसे हैंडल करेंगे?
I usually am very blunt on this. I'm not sure about how Ankur and Shilpa handle this, but I'm usually very blunt on this. I am a little clear that if you hire me and if you're going to tell me what you have to do, then it's no point hiring me. You rather do it yourself. You have the contractor, you have all the material information. At the max, if you need any help, you can call me. I will help you as a friend or as a, you know, just as a good gesture. Then you don't need my value addition. So ये जो डर है ना हमारे अंदर कि एक client चला जाएगा या एक project चला जाएगा, I think that needs to go away because frankly, if you're not doing things which you should be doing, you're not adding value to a project, then why do it at all? That is what my perception is. You all can differ.
I think I agree with you, Prashant. But then moving on to Ankur. Ankur, when you look at an essential factor for excellence in interior design, how do you define that?
Ankur, your mic is off.
Yes, Ankur, your mic.
Oh, yes.
No worries.
I think Prashant spoke extremely well. I think a designer, each one of us has our innate talent. And I think that the client nowadays, a nowadays client at least interviews or meets 5 to 10 other architects if we are Mumbai based or we are Delhi based, or I think depending on their since they know that, you know, if sometimes money is not the criteria and the fee is something that they are very clear that they're going to pay, they are really looking for their taste maker or for their you know, it's like a marriage. I feel interior design is a kind of a marriage wherein finding, you know, where the client and the architect or the interior designer are getting into a relationship of knowing all the nitty-gritties which happen in a family for the period when the house is getting done. And if the relationship and the marriage is a successful one, they build into even much more interesting relationships as time progress, wherein they can, like Prashant said, they can call you for any other advice also. I mean, that is the kind of relationship that can be built. So to me, one of the very important things is authenticity and honesty. I feel authenticity to your design and authenticity to your profession, because at the end of the day, we all are architects. We all are very hardworking, diligent, like Rishiji saying that, you know, we all want to do good work. That's the core that we've taken up this profession for. And that's why we are in it for so long. What do you say? I mean, Shilpa and Prashant, I think that all of us are battling so many challenges to make one project happen. We have tons of, you know, you have site work, you have contractors, you have vendors, you have so many clients, you know, clients to handle. So I think it's a mammothical task that we undergo. So authenticity and honesty to your profession is something which is the most important factor to me, which makes you excel in your design and want to keep doing it again and again. I mean, irrespective of any challenge that comes on your way, you are constantly growing, evolving, and doing project after project.
I think that
is a very important attribute.
How do you feel about this, Shilpa?
I agree with pretty much, you know, the entire line of thought that we are, you know, doing here. Like what Prashant said, you know, all about understanding the personality, having that honesty. What I would like to put this as, you know, that you have two aspects, I think, when you get into designing any sort of space, be it residential, be it any other typology, you know, or even a product for that matter. You know, you have the tangible and then you have the intangible. One of it is really asking you to get the understanding, that relationship, the, you know, the entire belief system or the value system that your user or your client or the person who's going to be, you know, visiting that space. That aspect is one whole aspect that you as a designer have to understand, you know, which directly will not happen if you are not going to hire this intermediary person. And then you have the tangibles or the products or, you know, the entire system that goes in, which is your architecture, your facade, your lighting. If I'm talking about just interior design, then, you know, your fixtures, your entire gamut that you put together. But this marrying of these two becomes this entire process, which then leads to the product, which is what leads to your final solution, you know. See, in the end, I think design is actually a problem solving.
Correct.
I mean, it is, you are finding a solution to a particular reason, whether it is to live, whether it is to enjoy, whether you're trying to visit a space. And what you as an architect is doing is really getting into the entire system that, you know, what is the culture, what is the belief, what is the value system that this particular client has, especially if it's a residence, then it really takes an important shape, you know. It's, again, it's different for a hospital versus a restaurant versus, you know, a public space in education building. So each of them sort of then have different tangibles and different intangibles. So you actually have to start getting these together to come up to this solution.
Correct. So that's a very nice feedback for the essential factors. So moving on, now that we know how essential factors matter to each one of you and how you look at it and how you perceive it when you're doing a particular project, how do you think the impact of interior design, you know, kind of happens when it comes to social or personal human behavior? You know, I personally believe that interior design or design of any kind has the potential to shape lives, to shape thought processes, to shape the kind of spaces that we live in, which is but obvious. And, you know, so let's say if you're doing, you know, designing a particular space for a client, you know, how do you measure the kind of impact that you want to build up on that particular space and, you know, in turn influencing the client's lives, you know, living life, you know, living style and so on and so forth?
Ankur, you want to go ahead?
Ankur, would you like to start on that?
Let's give Rishi ji an opportunity. He said, I'm going to come back. He's still not answered. Anjita, you...
I'll tell you.
No, we actually have to catch him. He has to start this.
I'll tell you I'll start with the previous one or I'll start with this one.
You can combine the two also.
For example, I'm doing a villa project. I used to do villa project. एक स्टेटस डेवलप करने के सिस्टम बताना पड़ता है. ऑल ऑफ अ सडन ही इज मूविंग आउट फ्रॉम अ स्मॉल हाउस टू अ विला, तो उसकी माइंडसेट, उसकी सारे चीजों को, तो वी यूज टू टीच देम अबाउट डिजाइन आल्सो. दिस इज व्हाट आई हैव अचीव टू गेट इनटू दिस काइंड ऑफ वर्क. आई यूज टू टीच माय क्लाइंट हाउ टू एडजस्ट योरसेल्फ इन दिस काइंड ऑफ थिंग्स व्हेन यू हैव ग्रोन अप in a society, so you have to stay in a very sophisticated manner to match up that level of society. So unko sikhana padta hai apne designs ke sath sath, unko educate karna padta hai unke way of thoughts, way of working, और उनको कैसे उसको मेंटेन करना है, क्या एक एक आप पे वे होते हैं उस डिजाइन के साथ जस्टिफाई करना, तो दीज थिंग्स एड प्लस पॉइंट टू माई वर्क माई प्रोफेशन. तो लोग मेरे पास कम फॉर दिस, दे कम फॉर डिजाइन अ विला अलॉन्ग विद दिस पार्ट. कि यार ऋषि जी हम लोग को इसको तरीका भी बताते हैं, खाली डिजाइन करके मैं चले जाऊं इट वोंट वर्क राइट. वो उसको मेंटेन नहीं कर पा रहे, ठीक है पैसे हैं बना तो लेते हैं सब, लेकिन उसको कंटिन्यू रखने के लिए कौन उनको सिखाएगा? उनके उनके लेवल के आदमी आके तो नहीं सिखाएंगे. तो आपको पैरेलली उनको सिखाना भी पड़ता है कि व्हेन यू जंप्ड अप इनटू अ न्यू सोसाइटी यू शुड नो हाउ टू मेंटेन, हाउ टू कीप, हाउ टू वर्क विद दिस. आपके एटीट्यूड्स, आपके पूरे पूरे आपके एक ऑरा चेंज करना पड़ता है जब आप एक नए सेगमेंट में जाते हो. तो दिस इज द थिंग व्हिच आई हैव डेवलप्ड इन माय सेल्फ व्हेन आई वर्क विद बिग क्लाइंट्स. तो मेरे को उनको प्रेजेंट करना. और एक चीज है कि प्रशांत सर जैसे बोले हैं कि आपकी एक पर्सनालिटी भी वैसी होनी चाहिए कि वो आपके ऊपर रिलाय करें राइट, कि आप इस चीज के साथ जस्टिफाई कर लो. तो ये सब चीज डिजाइन में आपके मायने रखते
हैं. सर मुझे अचानक एक सवाल याद आया, यू नो अ लिटिल ऑफ द टॉपिक, यू नो इफ आई मे, सिंस सर सेड कि यू नो एक पर्सनालिटी की भी एक इन्फ्लुएंस होनी चाहिए. सर हाउ मेनी पीपल हैव सेड दैट दे दैट यू रिमाइंड देम ऑफ एन इंडियन जेसन स्टैथम.
आई न्यू यू वर गेटिंग दैट. Too good.
मैं तो पूरी तरह से इस पर्सनालिटी से इन्फ्लुएंस्ड हूँ सर. I love Jason Statham and having one locally can't get better than this. What do you say, Shilpa?
Now that you're saying it, I'm starting to like relate and find connections.
है ना? I'm telling you. मैं पिछले 10 मिनट से actually यही सोच रही थी.
Shilpa is able to listen to background music now.
Yeah, I mean now I may just phase out for the next 15-20 minutes. You've talked about Jason's
time. Sab transporter mode mein chale jayenge, Rishi sir. But okay, Ankur, what do you have to say about this? You know, when we look at the impact of interior design on social and personal behavior. Ankur, your mic is again off.
I think you'll have to just leave it on.
Yeah. I just tend to unmute it because then sometimes it, you know, you can stream better and hear the other conversation. So definitely the impact on interior design where social is concerned and where personal human behavior is concerned, definitely. I think that spaces shape the people. But in that sense, are you asking us about a project like how we did and how it's impacted? Which direction are you thinking of, Ranjit?
So let's say, Ankur, if you've had a client where you felt that there was a major transition happening from one space to another, they were shifting, and you knew, you know, you felt that whatever you designed for them at that particular threshold, you know, would have a major impact for them in terms of, you know. A lot of times, you know, you suddenly move, like Rishi Shastra ne kaha, chote ghar se bade ghar mein shift hote. You know, in Bombay, hum log is concept ko bahut hi achhi tarah samajhte hain because from a 1 BHK, jab aap 3 BHK mein jate ho, okay, so you get used to managing a smaller amount of space, suddenly you are in a bigger amount of space and your kids have more space to play with, you know, they have more space. So then again, wo cleanliness ek factor ho jati hai, hygienic factor, design jo aap kar rahe ho, like, inclusion factor honi chahiye, you know, because we're used to a small space and you get into a large space. So inclusivity becomes an issue. I've seen a lot of times, you know, people feel disconnected if they're very small or nuclear families in very large spaces. Yeah, you know, the kind of design aesthetics that you bring into it, you know, a lot of people don't understand ki bhai mujhe bohemian pasand hai, mujhe chic pasand hai, mujhe tropical pasand hai, mujhe pastel shades pasand hai, you know, I like traditional design, I like contemporary, I like modern. Ye basic जो डिमार्केशन है आधे से ज्यादा लोग तो ये समझते ही नहीं है, तो डिजाइनर्स का काम है. बट देन यू नो टू इम्प्लीमेंट दैट, आप यू नो हाउ डू यू फील दैट इम्पैक्ट यू नो व्हेन यू आर डिजाइनिंग, हाउ डू यू परसीव द एंटायर सिचुएशन फ्रॉम द क्लाइंट साइड, एज ऑफ द क्लाइंट, देयर एग्जिस्टिंग लाइफस्टाइल, देयर अबाउट टू बिकम लाइफस्टाइल, यू नो द चेंज ऑफ देयर सोशल स्टेटस, हाउ डू यू गो अबाउट द होल थिंग?
I think the genre of clients, and it depends on what nature of client that we're working. But what I feel that what is, like I said, yes, it does impact. And no two spaces are the same for two faces. Just like each one of us has a different face and a different nature, I feel each family has had, whichever that we've done as a project is a different project. The nature of the client's grief is very different. You know, just off the cuff, I think one of the interesting parts that I really, which was an eye opener for us when we did this project, was an office space where we designed it for this client whose father could not see. Unfortunately, he was unable to see, but we worked out a circulation way in such a way that he knew the exact path and he would once be trained by someone to follow this path and count the steps and subsequently use that as a medium to always go to the toilet or go to the area. He is such an independent person that, I'm sorry, Ranjita, are you saying something?
No, I said, wow, that is amazing.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. And he's such an independent person that he doesn't want that someone has to hold my hand every time that I want to use the restroom or I want to be taken somewhere. He wants to visually feel his space or count the number or he's extremely sensitive on sound. And I think his other senses are extremely developed for him to be able to chart out. And it's so amazing that after so many years, we are going to do, you know, their house was again going to get done. So we said that it was something they had moved in. And this time again, we were doing. And the client told me, yeah, Ankur, you've designed this wall. It's going to be amazing for him to even to be able to feel the texture of this wall. And that will become his now guiding path in the house. So the office had its own thing. And after they were so happy, it took 2-3 years or something. And they've had like, they've loved the office. And they said that, you know, now, Ankur, we finally decided and we've been telling the kids and everyone and the wife have been telling the husband that, you know, it's time we have to do up the house. So now we're doing up the house. But I thought that spaces, yes, some, you know, these kind of unique situations happen rarely, but it is as an interior designer, you can shape the space as well as the lives of the individual living in the space.
Thank you, Ankur. That was a brilliant example. You know, this is exactly what I was trying to get to when I was talking. Impact. You basically discovered the Braille in design. You know, from what I understand, literally. I mean, you know, actually.
You are a pro. I think words belong to you.
I told you, we have to keep that direction.
No, no. But seriously, Rishi,
who writes all those idiots? That entire use framework is so well framed.
I'm going to let you in on a secret. I just rattled that off the top of my head. I actually don't form it. I just type whatever comes to the top of my head.
Wow.
Yeah. So
what belongs to you?
I mean, from about, you know, honors in English to events, basically. But let me tell you, if I have to pursue arts, there's nothing more beautiful or as immersive as architecture. And this is something that I've learned at the hard way. I mean, you just stand at one point in any given city and just look around you and you will realize that learning can never end.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Ranjita, we would love to design your space.
Free me kar rahe ho? Can't afford you. Guys, you guys are like amazing, amazing. Okay. Prashant, how do you look at impact?
I would just give a very quick and short example that I always try and debate with my clients, especially when we are doing homes. I ask them a question that how much time do you spend at home? So if, for example, the family is very small, a nuclear family usually, and there are like hardly 3 people in the house. And, you know, they, of course, not right now. Right now, people are spending the maximum time in their homes. But if they were on a normal day working, they used to spend like literally 10 hours at home, 10 to 12 hours maximum. And out of that, of course, 8 hours sleeping. So 4 hours, you're literally breathing the house and you're just leaving the house. That's it. So you're just coming, touching the house, sleeping, and then again getting up, dressed, and again away from it. So much of investment put into the house, and you're not enjoying the house. If you put a television in the living room and you start watching at the television and you just killing your entire family time with the television, how do you justify that family time in your home? So this is one question that I ask to all my clients. Okay, so now that is where the debate and the thought process starts. They now start thinking, because TV has made us all idiots that's the biggest idiot box, and it has made us all idiots because everybody wants to just stare at television, you know. So there is no learning, there is no communication, there is no dialogue happening between the family itself, because there is a television. Because there is another
member. I add there that our TV has conked off for an entire month, the last month, and we had made the decision of not putting a TV in the bedroom earlier. So now we are TV-less.
So basically, in short, that is what I'm saying, that when you are given that opportunity of spending that beautiful quality of 4 hours at home with each other, why surrender to an idiot box? And trust me, most of my clients have agreed to not put a television. Of course, there are luxury clients who prefer that, okay, don't put it in the living room. You make another theater room for us, and all of those things do happen. Of course, with every client's pocket, it all defines that if they have a deep pocket, they do go for a special theater room. But if they don't have, and they've realized the value of family time, most of my clients have agreed not to put a television in the living rooms. So the thought impact is the value addition that we bring to, and we bring that change, you know. And now they really, whenever we talk over the phone or something, they actually tell us that, we are finding it interesting and we are not missing on television. We are enjoying good family time. We get that few moments, we have dinner together, and we are not staring during the dinner. We are not staring at the television. We are rather talking to each other. So, you know, those little things make a huge impact in the way they function, in the way they communicate, in the way they behave. So I think that is a very, very minute and very small example. Yes, there are lot many steps like these in terms of your sustainable living, how you segregate your waste, all of those. So basically, if you keep going deeper into it, you kind of really can define a person's lifestyle. And that is really essential. And that is exactly what I meant when I said we have to do that value addition, because otherwise everybody knows everything. Everybody has access to everything. So that value addition is very, very, very essential for us.
I completely agree with you. I think, Prashant, that's a brilliant point that you have made, you know, to doing away with televisions from the living area, because yes, you know, eventually that is how the disconnection in families happen. You know, you're just so off from each other. You know, everybody is stuck to a gadget. You know, so even we've made a policy in our homes that no gadgets, you know, so it's 1 hour of gadget time through the day. And then you just leave those gadgets aside. You know, I mean, we don't want to be gadget addicts, basically.
Put the television in the most inconvenient area, ideally with a poor Wi-Fi. And trust me, it works the best.
So what do you do when people are in the same space with the mobiles, on each one's on their own mobile or iPad? Prashant, how do you control that?
I don't think he controls it.
That is beyond our controls now. But yes, I mean, people need to, of course, put that as well, because mobiles again are another.
No, Wi-Fi ka switch band kar do.
It's better hai ki aap bathroom ko design achhe karo, kyunki hamare yahan bathroom ka design achhi hota hai. So we work on bathroom.
इस बात पे इड्यूस डिजाइन डेविल का अवार्ड ऋषि सर को जाता है. टोटली अग्री विद हिम. ऋषि सर, 2 वर्सेस फॉर यू. बाथरूम की डिजाइन अच्छी होनी चाहिए. यू कैन स्पेंड योर बाथरूम टाइम अलोंग विद योर मोबाइल. मेक इट गैजेट फ्रेंडली, यू नो. प्रोबेबली हैव अ वेरी रीचेबल डिस्टेंस.
वहां वाईफाई अलाउड नहीं है. लेकिन अब बाथरूम बड़ी होगी जिससे कि 2 लोग घुस सके एट अ टाइम.
सर, आपके जो ये आइडियाज है ना, ये लगभग और रेडिकल होते जा रहे हैं. सर, इनफैक्ट वी कैन इवन लुक एट
ग्रुप सिचुएशन. एक्चुअली क्या है कि आप तीनों जो हैं वो मेट्रो से बिलोंग करते हैं. मैं एक 2 टायर सिटी से बिलोंग करता हूँ. मेरे यहाँ के क्लाइंट के थॉट प्रोसेस अलग है, आपके यहाँ के क्लाइंट के थॉट प्रोसेस अलग है, स्पेस अलग है. हमारे यहाँ पर जो डिजाइन करते हैं वो कुछ लोगों को दिखाने के लिए भी बनाते हैं, और आपके यहाँ पर जो डिजाइन होती है वो फंक्शनेबल होती है ज्यादातर। हम लोग के यहाँ फंक्शनेबल के साथ साथ भी हम थोड़े से ऑरा जनरेशन में भी चले जाते हैं। हमारे यहाँ पर दो लिविंग एरिया, एक वाइफ बैठेगी अपनी फ्रेंड के साथ, एक हस्बैंड बैठेगा अपने फ्रेंड के साथ। वाइफ को टीवी चाहिए भाई, वरना आपको घर में रहने नहीं मिलेगा, राइट? तो दिस थिंग्स हैपेंस। तो बाथरूम इज द बेस्ट प्लेस टू इन्वेस्ट, आई थिंक सो।
आई गेस ऑल ऑफ अस आर लर्निंग समथिंग फ्रॉम दिस। हां प्रशांत, अंकुर, शिल्पा, व्हाट डू यू से?
यस डेफिनेटली।
सी बेसिकली दैट मींस के अब यू नो देयर इज नो पॉइंट ऑफ ट्राइंग टू यू नो figure out other expensive amenities to buy. अगर EMI चालू कराना ही है, टू टायर सिटी में चलो भाई, वहाँ पे लैंड खरीदो, वहाँ पे घर खरीदो, वहाँ पे EMI चालू कराओ। You see the kind of, you know, plus factors which will influence your life, you know. You get to have your own living space for a man, that is unthinkable in the city, even for a woman, you know, because you're all in the same space actually. Yeah. There is space. Space is a luxury.
I think culturally, it also depends culturally. Up in the north, like when we work also, I've done some work in the north. I feel culturally people operate very differently. Sometimes if a family is a very politically driven family, they have to have their meeting spaces. They need to have the women. And so I think it depends a lot on the nature of the client, their requirements. And
I totally agree on that.
And aspiration is key. I mean,
yes. Yeah, completely. Yeah. I totally go for it.
Like how Prashant is value adding, and he's just building on, you know, he's building a new aspirational life for the people who are living.
Correct.
They've already seen this. So now what is the new thing he is? So I think aspiration is key over here.
I think, Prashant, what you spoke about this entire TV-less living space, I think that's a brilliant, brilliant point. And we should all think about it. In fact, we can try even incorporating game space, traditional gaming spaces like Carom and Ludo and things, you know, which actually bring the family together. We as kids, we've enjoyed that thoroughly. And then suddenly there was this huge gap in between where, you know, technology and gadgets started taking up everybody's time. So we all sare phones, pe, laptops, pe, tablets, pe, us pe hi ghus gaye. You know, कहीं पे हमारे बच्चों को ये बात समझ में ही नहीं आ रही है कि भाई, you know, carom can be enjoyed. They think it is boring. They'd rather play digital. Hey, digital Ludo, digital carom, क्या होता है?
Digital Ludo.
My daughter's added me to some Ludo King and all that. And that is
digital. I've heard of digital Ludo.
A few days back, when this lockdown started, my son found a Ludo board. But we didn't have the
गोटिया
तो हमने क्या किया, हम जस्ट किचन गए, हमने चार चने लिए, चार राजमा लिए, यू नो, सो वी जस्ट टुक आउट दीस एंड वी क्रिएटेड आवर ओन
ओके दिस द यूटिलिटी अवार्ड फॉर डिजाइन डेवलपमेंट इज गोइंग टू प्रशांत चौहान।
सर डाइस कहां से लाए? डाइस मेन थिंग इज डाइस, वेयर इज द डाइस?
This was मन से जो भी नंबर आए ना, मन की बात उसने प्रशांत ने बोल दी क्या रंजीता? मन की बात
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल, हाँ हाँ, मन से मन को जोड़ो।
नहीं नहीं, मोदी जी के मन की बात ही
से प्रशांत ऐसा है, बालकनी में खड़े होने का और ध्यान से सुनने का, बाजू वाला जो है ना, कितनी बार उसने थाली बजाई, that's the number you play.
Shilpa,
okay. What are
you and Sameer playing?
All pun intended, Shilpa.
I was just going to say, do you want to know that on the, you know, the WebEx?
No, right now? Your son, how old is your son?
So our son is 9. And, you know, just coming back to your entire human, you know, impact of spaces on human behavior and vice versa, like, you know, how human behavior impacts spaces. You know, I think this entire 2 months that we've spent in a really small size Mumbai home has taught us so much. I mean, you know, using a particular space, you know, you, every person, you know, you have your, there's this whole circle of space around you. You have your first circle is your intimate space, like your very private space. you know, the next one, you kind of have this personal space where you only let the personal people around you. And then you kind of move to your social circle, which is like your friends and people you want to spend, you know, other time with. And then you have that whole public space, which is probably, you know, your strangers or people that you don't know. But these are the circles that you're actually designing your space around for. And I think as designers, this is what we need to understand when we are talking to our client, what each of these circles means for our client within their space. Like, you know, in their house, for us, like our living room is like an all encompassing space. We're using it for everything right now, whether it is work, games, eating, dining, you know, like 15 functions are happening here right now. For somebody else, for a client that we designed, you know, a really lovely aspirational home who moved from a small two-bedroom house to like a 5,000 square feet home with his entire three-generation family, that space for them, we realized, was the kitchen. You know, there was a dining room, but the dining room was barely used. The kitchen became like this central space where, you know, from morning to evening, each person sort of came at that breakfast counter, you know, whether it was the elderly, then the kids, then the couple, you know, the connections at food, at cooking, at dining, and, you know, discussing stuff or whatever, was just the entire experience of the house. And that actually became the central space. So, you know, you may think that, oh, you know, in a Mumbai home, I won't waste space. I'll just do the required space for a kitchen. Why give like a 500 square feet kitchen, you know, whatever the amount of the house is. But for a client like that, we realize, no, the kitchen can actually be bigger. The dining room is probably only used when guests come in. But okay, the kitchen is where they are spending most of their time.
Like more social, know, more inclusive. Yeah,
so that was their space for social interaction. Or, you know, they are sort of personal moments. And then rooms are obviously more intimate moments for each person of the family. Like the daughter had her own requirements. The son had his own requirements. The grandparents had a very specific set of requirements. So those were their intimate set of requirements, which, you know, were different. And then you have your social, like a public space. So if they had they were also religious. So, you know, this entire party hall sort of space where maybe a group of 50 people were going to come. So that becomes like your social space where people are going to come. So that's where that little shosha also comes into picture, because, you know, they're going to enter the house. They're probably not going to enter any of your private spaces. This is where they're going to really come, like the outsiders, and they're going to go out of there. So it's a completely different sort of mentality when you're designing that space. So I think it completely relates to the human behavior, how you are sort of connecting with that space and to what level of relationship, you know, what is that relationship with the other person in that space also matters a lot.
Right.
So I think it all comes back to human connection and behavior.
Shilpa, on that note, you know, I have seen a couple of restaurant projects which you have done off late, okay? And most of the restaurant projects that you've done, you know, how I'm following those projects and, you know, when you publish them, they're very warm. They're cozy. They have very natural colors, and you've always tried to kind of, you know, infuse 50% of daylight, you know, natural light, and 50% of, you know, electrical light, you know, technically, whatever and however. When I see that space, it's very, it gives me a very warm welcome feeling, in spite of the fact that maybe I'm entering that space for the first time. It feels, you know, gives you that sense of familiarity.
Yes.
You know, where you know that, you know, you could just sit down and, you know, kick your shoes off and put up your feet and pick up a menu and just go into it and, you know, plug in your headphones, get on your laptop, do your stuff. So I've seen that feel. So when you're designing a restaurant, a hospitality space, okay, and you're bringing those kind of design sensibilities onto the plate, you know, when you're actually trying to make it more and more inclusive, interactive, you know, it's gelling more and more, it's becoming more a part of the client's life. What exactly goes through your mind, you know, when you look at a space like that? What are the first two things which strike you as important when you look at the space and before you started the project?
Restaurants are actually a great example of the user connection, the relatability that you're talking about, the experiences and the memories that you generate. you know, you go to a restaurant, you spend probably only 3 hours there. But those 3 hours and the people that you're spending it with, you know, whether it's a couple dinner, whether it's a family dinner with your kids, or whether it's a fun time with your friends, you know, that when it merges with the memories of the space and the ambiance that has sort of connected with it, and of course the wine and the music adds to it. But I'm just saying that whole experience wants you to come back to the space the second time or the third time, because you are relating to it. It's become this moment and this experience in your brain, you know, and you're sort of registering it, and you want to relate to this and come back. I mean, today you take a selfie, you know, it's actually like our clients are actually asking us to design selfie points spots, because that is going to help them generate, you know, people are going to want to use those corners, take selfies, and then come back to the space, because they're going to look at it and say, oh, you know, we've not gone here for so much time, let's go back. So it works. It actually works in the brain. And so what happens is the whole intention is first to understand what the cuisine, what the client really wants, whether he is looking for this sort of a warm space where people feel that, you know, it shouldn't be intimidating. You want to come back. You know, even if it is expensive, it's okay. But expensive is one thing on the price list, but it shouldn't feel intimidating. So that's a very tricky situation. A fine dine can be fine by the experience, but doesn't have to feel fine by the materials and the intimidating factor. So how do you gel those two?
I think I completely understand what you're trying to say. In fact, I'll give you an example of something very similar that's happened to me. If you go to Sahara Star in Mumbai, you know, they have a Mediterranean restaurant, and they have salt and all. And the Mediterranean, you know, can put you back by almost about 12 to 15,000 rupees, you know, for a couple dinner. So once I went there, you know, with my husband, and the best thing was, you know, he couldn't believe how expensive it was because he didn't like the decor. He said it made him feel depressed for some reason.
Yes.
You know, there was too much of dark browns and reds and reddish colors happening, you know. So the yellows were very far away. So they tried to make it more like Aladdin and the flying carpet in that Aladdin and Chalice Chor.
Yeah.
You know, so it we actually, you know, I mean, we landed up spending a huge amount of money, and then we were feeling dissatisfied. The food was amazing, but the feeling was not one of content, probably because the psychological, you know, impact of that entire space was just not happening. And so then if you look at the other restaurants,
impact on your entire senses, basically. So restaurant design is all about your sense, you know, the five sensories, the visual, you know, the audio, like the touch, the feel, the fragrances of the food. There's actually, do you know that, you know, people who sell like really good biryani, they actually also have this sort of scent that is put into the tandoor sometimes, which makes you want to eat that biryani, the Subway bread smell. You know,
I'll tell you what that smell is.
You are attracted to Subway because of the smell first, and then you see the food and the taste.
Ranjita knows some
secret. I know. I'll tell you the smell. It's kyore ka pani mixed with meetha attar and rose water. And it has zafran in it, and it has to be mixed with milk and poured on top of the biryani before you put it on the dam. I know this because my husband's a great biryani maker. He's got an alternate career mode in that. Let me tell you this.
But even the koila adds a lot of fragrance. I don't know if you, Ranjita, and all, you made the with the arteka thing and the koila. I think
it's
the subtle things that we don't. We need to get the Nawabi recipes.
Yeah, the koila will give you a different flavor. If you're using wood in a tandoor, again, it will give you a different flavor because the smoke that emanates from that, each one to their own flavors, and you know, so that gets infused. So I don't.
All are cooking now.
Now we are all cooking.
We're all silent
completely. Ah, you know, we are chefs. We are giving good competition to each other.
I was just thinking whether now I'm there in some. Cookery show or something like that.
Rishi sir, aapne paani ubala.
We all are changing recipes nowadays anyways a lot. To keep everyone
next in line is a kitchen show. But you are getting back to it. So now that we have discussed how the impact of interior design, you know, is you know, kind of affects us on a day-to-day basis. If you had to choose one aspect of a principle or an element of interior design, which is what would be your critical go-to factor? which one would you choose? Prashant, let's start with you.
Sorry, that, could you please repeat the question?
Let's say, you know, we have certain principles and elements, certain elements that contribute to interior design. So let's say if you had to choose one principle or one particular element, that is your fail-safe go-to factor in interior design, what would you choose? Would you choose color, form, shape?
I always rely on light.
Light, okay. What about you, Ankur?
Natural or artificial, both. But light is very, very, very essential.
Okay. Okay. Ankur, how about you?
Since we spoke of cooking, I feel it's always a symbiosis of a lot of things. So it's not like a formula where you say, you know, or a recipe, itna, you know, 5% of light, 2% of color, you know, 3% of form, your dish is ready. So, taking off from that. I think it's a symbiosis of a lot of elements that make it. And for me, I would say that there is not one particular thing for a particular, for each and every project, something has taken precedence. It could be where it was a huge villa, so whether, you know, the landscape and how we addressed it from inside and outside, that entire element of, you know, blurring of boundaries became very important. It could have been a retail space where there was nothing that we wanted to show outside and we just wanted to showcase the product. And there was, you know, we had to rely on the artificial light more so. So I feel that, to me, I would say symbiosis of a lot of elements is something that I really go for. And I think that project by project, it starts unfolding.
Okay. Rishi sir, how do you feel about this? As I ate cheese.
I go with light.
Okay, you go with light. So, a mixture of natural daylight and...
Definitely I'll go with the light, both natural and artificial light.
Okay. Shilpa, what about you?
I think it's more on the lines of what Ankur is saying. You know, I think it needs to be harmony, you know, harmony of everything, like whether it's, you know, whether it's the form, whether it's the function, it's the textures, the layers, if you have an opportunity of the nature coming in, the light coming in the right, you know, right spots, because you don't always have the opportunity to get everything. So I think you have to sort of make an entire harmony, whatever is possible in that particular site or the situation or the requirement also, because we've also designed hospitals, you know, and they are a completely different. I mean, if I would say for a hospital, for example, you know, giving patients nature, access to nature and natural light, or even good art, if you didn't have, you know, natural light, would probably heal them. And there's actually evidence that they get healed in lesser days than the days they would have taken otherwise. So, you know, those kind of aspects, I think you really have to take whatever best possible for that particular function, because it's also dependent on what the function of that space is.
Correct. No, I think I agree with both aspects. I think the men love the light. Welcome to the light. And the women love the harmony and the, you know, synchronized factor of all things coming together.
Women are always about balance, right?
Balance. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Women are always seeking balance.
But men are far-sighted, so they need light.
This is going to be a gender-driven discussion now. This is so interesting. Our Jason Statham has spoken, okay? Okay. So then, Prashant, let's say, you know, if you look at human factors, as you ate cheese, you know, when you're interacting or when you see the family who's going to occupy that space or the kind of clientele, like, you know, we discussed restaurants also, Shilpa. So let's say one human factor, which becomes a key factor for you every time by default, you know, because we will, you know, when we look at a project, we will consider a lot of different factors, you know, contributing it. But sometimes there is that one factor, which is a consistent factor, which is present effervescently, basically. You know, so Prashant, if you have to pick one factor, what would that factor be?
Human perspective. I'm not really sure of what is that one human factor, because every space is very personal. So there has always been always a personal answer to every personal space. You know, every space has its own answer. So I don't think there is just one common thread. But of course, yes, human centric designs are always, we are designing for people eventually. So, but that there is not one single aspect that ki sirf isi ke around sab kuch revolve karega. But there is always, like, for example, if somebody is looking for say an entire dark palette, we obviously have to kind of work around that dark palette, even with light or even with, so there is always a taste of the client also, which has to be kept as an aspect. And I think a human desire or the aspiration or the there has to be that dream, that dream has to be achieved, you know. So you can't really pinpoint at one factor that there is only one human factor which is the only aspect where you build around it. It has always been project to project basis, so never kind of just one single aspect.
Okay, but you know, when you were saying that, Prashant, I suddenly remembered something. I don't know if you've seen the movie 50 Shades of Grey, and there is this huge house which has a red room.
Yeah.
Okay, so people out there jinko red room ke bare mein nahi pata hai, hum aapko explain nahi karenge. We are not explaining it on this platform. Please go watch the movie, because then you will understand what I mean by the human factor, particular demand. Okay,
exactly. That is what he wants. That is what Mr. Grey would want.
Yeah.
Probably Mr.
Okay, Prashant, we are getting the grays and the whites and the blacks. We're getting all of it.
Exactly. So there is never that one. So it's always about
just talk. I remembered
the human ego. I am assuming that.
A lot of people would say that, you know, I want my space to be more comfortable. I like cozy. Okay, somebody would say that I want it utilitarian, you know. I want it minimalistic. I just want whatever, you know, jitna bare minimum ho sakta. You know, somebody says ki mujhe to pastel palette ke saath hi chalna hai. Because I like light spaces aur mujhe light ko enhance karna hai. There's some people who like dark. I, for personally, you know, I like dark. I think, you know, dark has a lot more potential than light. Light, so, you know, however you can just manipulate. But dark colors, dark shades, you know, dark shaded upholstery, dark shaded furnishing, dark floors, these are things which can be, you know, they have to be very,
very tricky
manipulated. Very, very tricky to play with, you know. Two dark colors, one light color, two light color, one dark, one light. Okay. Two dark colors to play with. Like, you know, I personally like the dark bottle green and I like the dark indigo blue. How would you combine it? Two very tricky colors to play with, but just love the two coming together.
Sanjita, I would say that, you know, the human factor that we are talking about, really, you know, if I had to say, which really runs through each and every project, is that emotional connect.
Yeah.
I think emotional connect, I mean, it explains everything that you all are saying in terms of who, you know, veers towards what, but once any individual has an emotional connect to something, that is, you know, that is when you have struck the chord. Like, I think that's when you're making music like like Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. You know what I feel? So
yes, I feel that.
And trust me, it's the biggest challenge. Okay, I think for all the viewers who are watching, and to feel that, you know, you've struck, you know, you've hit the bullseye. It's a tall order. I mean, because your nature is always something which is different from the client whom you are interacting with. You and I mean, we're not a perfect match, right? We don't always share the same natural tendencies. So to be able to strike that emotional connect, to be able to understand the person's needs, at the same time, to be able to that person to develop the trust and faith that you are going to be able to give it to him, you know, or you are able to guide him or create a space which is going to be something, because for everyone, a house is a very precious, and you want the house to live 15 years. So I feel that bond and that emotional connect to establish between the architect and the client, and to establish with each and every individual, is the toughest thing. But once you're able to do that, you're able to give them a space which creates memories. You know, at the end of the day, everyone wants memories. I had this client, you know, one of the most amazing thing he said to me, he said, you know, Ankur, I just want a space where I can create memories. And trust me, he's one of, I mean, I really can't take names, but I mean, I was extremely touched. He's someone who's really looked up, you know, he's quite well known. But I think that was brilliant. I mean, I thought I was taken aback for 2 minutes. I said, that's a brief 2 year. I mean, this day and age for someone to say just one sentence, this is what I want.
So, you have to hold on.
I can't take the name.
No worries, but you hold on to him. Everybody will be making a grab for him. He looks like a dream client. It sounds like one of those clients with a dream brief. You know, every architect wants a brief like that, you know, where they can really explore all potentials. Rishi sir, आपको क्या लगता है? एक ऐसा factor, you know, human factor, जो आपको influence करे.
Emotional attachment रहते हैं सबको. That is the most common factor with everybody. जब भी वो कोई भी मेटल्स को या कोई भी एरिया को डिजाइन करने आते हैं तो दे हैव सम पर्टिकुलरली कुछ इमोशंस पार्ट को लेके डिस्कस करते हैं कि आई वांट दिस थिंग इन माय हाउस. तो ये एक कॉमन फैक्टर है जो कि आपको ये एरिया में टू टायर सिटीज में मिलते हैं. मैंने नॉर्मली आई फाइंड दिस थिंग इन दिस टू टायर. तो इमोशनली अटैच्ड वर्ड्स व्हाट दे वांट टू डू, वो उसको एक लेगेसी के रूप में छोड़ना भी चाहते हैं क्योंकि तो ये मेरे बेटे के लिए एक लेगेसी रहे, तो ये भी उनके साथ जुड़ा. तो हम लोग को जो भी डिजाइन करना है इट शुड बी फॉर अ लॉन्ग पीरियड सो दैट दे कैन गिव इट टू द नेक्स्ट जनरेशन एज अ लेगेसी.
राइट,
सो दिस थिंग आई फाउंड
दैट इज वेरी वेल पुट ऋषि सर, दैट यू आर लीविंग बिहाइंड अ लेगेसी. Because I think that is a dream of every architect also who puts their passion and all that effort into creating something. You know, you're leaving a little bit of you behind in every single project that you're doing. It's like little leaving a little bit of your legacy behind in that project as well.
Yeah, even it is workable for us also.
Exactly. So I think that's a very beautiful thought. Chilpa, what do you think?
So to limit to one might be difficult, but I think definitely for us, you know, the client understanding, the functionality, the comfort, all these are of utmost importance. You know, aesthetics will eventually go hand in hand because, you know, that is why they get an architect on board. But I think after that, to put all this together, personalization of the space becomes very important.
Okay.
And I think that is the human factor that you have to bring in as an architect. How do you make that space theirs? You know, you started designing this space as, you know, your design and your sort of baby, with taking their needs and their requirements and understanding their lifestyle. And how do you give it back to them by adding that level of personalization, you know, as layers, as textures, whether it is their love for travel, whether it's their love for art, you know, whether it's sort of, I don't know, they are, if there's kids, then their own art. Like we actually, you know, we actually get our clients' kids to sort of tell what they like in terms of their talent. And then we try to figure out how we can conceptualize that in the form of an art. For an office that we recently did, we got the employees to, you know, take up an entire column and just doodle an entire concrete column with chalk. And then we obviously helped them to sort of fine tune it. But that made that space personal, you know. Even though it was an office, which, you know, offices are not always personalized to the employees because it is all about the employer really. But
right,
in this case, this was not just the employer. Even the employees felt that this is our space. So we actually had like, you know, these arches where we had put these threads put up where all the employees' photographs were put up and they would keep changing it every month. So the flexibility and the personalization of the space became a very important aspect. Even if you're designing a hospital room, where does the patient himself keep his personal things, you know, like his kid's picture maybe, or something else, like a personal item. So how do you personalize every public space also? I think that to bring in into design becomes very important for us, and it connects the entire emotional value that we are talking about as a space, you know, and what you bring in.
Thank you so much, Shilpa. I think, you know, the discussion for human factor elements for design, I think totally belongs to you in this discussion. Very beautifully put. Thank you. I think we've all learned from this that, you know, it is we need to kind of just bring that emotional value into a transition mode for personalization. It's not enough that you just do it as per, you know, how the client feels, you know, or connects with, but you also give that extra layer of, you know, potential for personalization. Brings about that comfort factor. Thank you so much on that, Shilpa. Moving on to our next topic, design is something that I believe is the first step for better living. exactly what all we've been discussing till now. So, you know, when we talk about better living and why design is actually a stepping stone for it, okay, how would you like to define it? This is completely individual perspective. आप चारों का अपना अपना एक आइडिया है कि आपको ऐसा क्यों लगता है कि डिजाइन बहुत जरूरी है एक बेटर लिविंग मोड के लिए. यू नो, हम अपनी लाइफ को कैसे थोड़ा सा ऑर्गेनाइज, थोड़ा सा स्ट्रक्चर, थोड़ा सा एस्थेटिकली ब्यूटीफुल, हर एक चीज को हम इम्प्लीमेंट कर सकते हैं विद दैट सिंपल टेकिंग अ स्टेप फॉरवर्ड टुवर्ड्स डिजाइन. प्रशांत, आपको क्या लगता है?
I think this is something that we already discussed, like about the television factor or all of those things. So we have already established the idea that yes, design is very essential, and how you can personalize your own space and speak without talking with your space. You know, like for example, if somebody sees your space, they know and relate to you that this has to be your space. This has to be your home, your office, or your
Your personality.
So reflecting your personality, I think that is what we've already kind of established in this conversation.
Rishi sir, आप कैसे इस चीज को देखते हैं कि design better living के लिए, you know, it is a first step towards better living. आपको कितना relevant लगता है ये बात?
ये सही है. आपको ये खुशी देता है घर में. साथ साथ आपकी सोसाइटी में कोई भी लोग आपके जब घर आते हैं, वो एक आपके ऑरा या आपके वे ऑफ लिविंग को देख के एक आपके ऊपर में पॉजिटिव वाइब्स रखते हैं. आपके रहन सहन से वो आपके ऊपर में एक फेथफुलनेस जगाते हैं. तो डिजाइन आपको पर्सनली और आपके जो एरिया या जो भी आपके सोसाइटीज में जो फ्रेंड्स हैं या जो भी है, उन तक आपका एक मैसेज देता है कि हाउ यू आर, व्हाट काइंड ऑफ पर्सन यू बिलोंग टू. You can't speak every time कि मैं ऐसा हूँ, मैं ऐसा हूँ. Your design, way of designing your house, your keeping your house speaks of. That is my way of personalizing about designs.
What about you? How do you feel about this?
I'm sorry. I thought you said on me.
Yes, I just called upon you, Ankur. How do you feel about this? You know, when we say design is the first step towards better living.
That design is essential. And to me, I have always been saying this since long, that design is my language. English is a byproduct for me to express it. That is, so that's always the way I think about design. To me, it begins with, I think for each and everyone, design is something that is there, but you just don't appreciate. I mean, the very fact that you wake up in the morning to your phone or to your clock and you see an item which is design. I mean, your choice of whether you chose the iPhone or you chose the Android or whatever, you go towards the slimmer phone to use as a device to set an alarm or to begin your day with, is all designed. I mean, on what basis do you gravitate towards a product, or on what basis that you like to live your life? So I feel your day begins with design. You just don't realize it. On a spiritual note, I've always felt also, which is, I know it's, I'm adding on, it's, I always say that live life by design and not by default. And I mean by that always is also that you can design your life also. I mean, obviously we are designers and we are designing the space, but there is this entire thing that, you know, a thought can change million lives. And it really depends on how you think of things. You know, everyone's heard of all those positive thinking books. And I think each one of us is has a thought. And on those basis, are we being able to design and give things to our clients based on our philosophy and thought process? So to me, I feel, like I said, design is just so integral that I just feel that if people are able to appreciate design, they will be able to enjoy design even much more better, you know? And that's how you will be able to enjoy it even in the smaller elements of design. So in this process of designing people's homes is, I think that's how we, you know, educate people or, you know, share with them this entire ideology of that it is designed, you know, there's nothing which is, even a small tap is designed. The way, you know, the way you put your bath towel that is designed, whether it's in a stool, it's a ladder. I think so many small things are all designed. I mean, whether it's a small place, it's a small space, or it's a large bungalow, you ensure that each and every item and necessity of the client is all taken care of. You've designed it. It's not by default that it kind of reached there. So to me, I feel I'm very profoundly for design. I mean, I think I eat, drink, swear design.
We totally agree. What about you, Shilpa? How do you feel? Relevant, not relevant,
definitely relevant. In fact, for me, I would probably go on a much larger and a macro picture. I feel like design should be everybody's birthright. Like you need it. I mean, why should it be that, you know, design should be only a privilege of few? You know, everybody should be able to access design, a good design. I mean, you know, whether you're talking about good city planning, good public spaces, good transport design, good slum housing design, or, you know, affordable housing design. It should not be that because I do not have enough budget, I should not be able to get good design. I mean, I don't know how do we, you know, it's a big platform to cross, and as a world, as a country, as a city, everything. But I think design should be everybody's birthright. It should just be there. I mean, everybody should have access to it. Like, you know, today, if we are designing, I mean, if somebody is doing BMC schools, they need to look as beautiful, have as much as natural light and ventilation like any other international school or an ICC school. Why should it be any different?
That's a very valid point, especially considering that we've been seeing discussions or upcoming discussions where people have been talking about where even Sir Ratan Tata has also commented as to how architects have to get rid of centralized slums. And then there are people who are discussing vertical slumming issues and all of that. So, you know, I've been seeing this design and the slum factors being featured in a lot of conversations. And I just feel like turning around and telling them that, hey, bro, it's not just about the vertical or the horizontal slumming. We are slumming. Have we ever realized this? We are slumming. It's become like a 9-to-9 living life for us.
I mean, I want to add here that today in this entire COVID crisis, you know, maximum work is being done by the doctors, the nurses in all the BMC hospitals, which probably are in double, triple, four times capacity. And, you know, whenever they were planned and designed, unfortunately, they were not at that level of design. But I think that those were the ones who needed it the most today, right? I mean, this is where all the groundwork is really happening.
No, I agree with you. And I also feel, I somewhere believe that, you know, we should also take some amount of lesson. Hame thode bahut, you know, hum jahan pe tourist ban ke ghumne jaate, I think it is high time we learn from them. You know, this is something which I've been repeating in all my webinars. I have been talking about this specifically to architects and designers, because I feel that, you know, people who understand the meaning, it should, you know, originate there, from there, you know, the change. Okay, we talk about sustainability. Okay, let us not claim our knowledge of sustainability when we are stepping out of our houses in a four-wheeler to travel a distance of 2 kilometers, thereby adding to a carbon footprint. We should not do that. That is not being sustainable. You know, you travel to European countries, you see people actually using a bicycle. You know, if you go to Singapore, the right to owning a car would actually be more expensive than actually buying a car. Yeah. You know, so this is the way they've controlled pollution. This is the way they've actually promoted public transportation. And then that's when you can truthfully say that I'm not slumming. I have a good life. I have a comfortable life. I'm happy with the way I live. You know, I am happy with not just my personal four walls, but when I step outside those four walls, you know, I'm not slumming. So right now, when we are talking about these kind of aspects, and I think it's very unfortunate that it took a COVID-19 for us to realize ke hum saaf hawa mein saans le sakte hain, hamare roads saaf ho sakte hain, hamare nadiyon ki pani saaf ho sakti hai, and we can see, you know, marine life in the seas. You know, it's very unfortunate that it took a COVID-19 for us to realize all this. We should have actually realized at our own end, you know, the potential of the environment, the potential of a better life. You know, better life is not about the affordability. Better life is how we utilize the natural aspects of the resources given to us by nature itself, you know, and I think we've misused that enough. But thank you, Shilpa. I think I agree with you that yes, design should be a birthright. Probably that is the only way that we will encourage people to use that part of their brains where they think beyond I. They start thinking we. Right now, we are just thinking I. It's about me. It's about just I, you know. Me, myself, and Eddie Kynes. But, you know, I think that, you know, Eddie or no Eddie, but we need to think in a much more comprehensive and a much more inclusive manner. But this round definitely belongs to Ankur. I love that quote of yours that design, we should live by design, not by default. Ankur, are you there?
Yeah, very much.
Yeah, I
but
think,
you know what, Ranjita, trust me, you know, we've been also really thinking about it. So unfortunately, we've not done a hospital, but I heard, you know, some of these patients and you kind of hear some interviews online and they were like, even for the patients who have been locked into these spaces, you know, everyone really is looking forward to hospitals designed extremely efficiently, extremely well, hygiene levels extremely high. You know, we really need government to, I don't know, Ranjita, given that you talk on several platforms, we really need the government to engage with so many set of architects that all of us are. I think so many of us would be willing, I mean, I'm talking for myself, would be willing to do a little bit pro bono to ensure that your government hospitals can be, you know, brought up to a certain standard, because you feel for all these things, but you just, there are so many times that you don't know how the government can connect with architects, because I think it's such a beautiful fraternity. All of us are now getting together and we're all able to come on the same single platform and page. And we all want to make a change for society.
In fact, why just hospitals, even urban spaces?
Urban spaces also, yeah.
So,
No, completely. I'm just saying, I think our biggest challenge, and I think Prashant, Shilpa, and Rishiji, I don't know. I genuinely feel that we all feel as if, you know, we want to transform society. We are now at this beautiful stage wherein we have the knowledge, we have the technique, we have the ability, we have material, we have the ability to execute it to international levels, right? I think everyone's work now is international level work, but we just are unable to, you know, kind of synchronize with the government to make all these visions happen. There are proposals and proposals where people are willing to make and do, but we are just not able to translate. I mean, to me, even living in an apartment building, I mean, I envy Rishiji, he's living in a bungalow and he was sitting in his garden. We, even living in an apartment is like living in a vertical slum. I mean, it's just that just because it's glazed and it is a more sugar-coated building doesn't mean that it is, you know,
actually,
less.
I think it makes you slum more, because by the time it's glazed and it's sugar-coated and it's got a glass facade, you've added on so much of expenses in air conditioning because that building is heating up that, you know, your wallets are getting thinner by the day because you're busy paying electrical bills, no electricity bills.
Yeah, and not to mention one of the buildings where they're not even given balconies out or any windows that barely open and tilt and turn.
Exactly. God forbid you have natural air and ventilation and natural daylight. No. It is all about those concealed LED and halogens. And it's all about those huge ventilator fans. And it's all about the central air conditioning. And then you think, oh my God, what a structure. And that's when I turn around and say, oh, please go to Sheesh Mahal, you know, with Jaipur. Please go take it there. You know, that's been like, that's centuries old, you know. And guess what? It's natural cooling, natural light, pieces of mirror. How did they keep that huge a structure cool? They have actually kept it so beautifully cool. Even if you go in the summers and you stand there in the evening about 4:35, there's like a cool breeze, you know, which is flowing through every dark, damp corner also. Provided, you know, considering the fact that it's not really as well maintained as it should be as a historical, you know, structure. But even then, you know, that is something that we should be learning from. You know, sustainability.
Completely agree. Ranjita, lack of knowledge is not a problem right now, I feel. Everyone is aware of everything. I think that each and every architect is itching to see the change in society and to be able to transform the whole nation to have beautiful spaces. I mean, and it doesn't mean that it's a metropolis or it's a two-tier. There should be no words used to say, this is two tier or this is three tier or this is a mega city. It is a one single country. We belong to India, the nation. I mean, and the nation is has so much land that if you, you know, apportion all the people around and give them amenities, there is no looking back. If we had connectivity and transportation all throughout the country, which was seamless, I don't think I would mind living in, like, you know, a few kilometers away in one of the green lands or in a farm. And I think that I would say for anyone, you know.
Ankur, everything that you've spoken till now basically triggers our understanding of what is happening around us, okay? When you speak about how architects should be coming together with the government. I think currently in the last couple of months, a situation has ensued, which has shown that the government really doesn't understand how architecture or public spaces has to be manipulated. And I'm talking about the very famed and defamed topic of the Central Vista. Okay, so when we are talking about 87 acres of public space, when we are talking about a second parliament building, we are not talking about the possibilities of reinventing or refurbishing the existing structure. We are talking about occupying public land and then doing something about it. Okay, so that's one aspect of it. There is another aspect of it when people might say that, no, it's probably going to make the whole place better. Okay, however, we have not really seen any images, you know, projections of how that space would look after they had done with whatever they're planning. Okay, so there's no transparency of what's actually being planned, which is something which definitely gives me the jitters. So when I think about my, you know, a very teeny tiny little part, obviously, in that 20,000 crore, the money that I paid to the government as a taxpayer, right? And then I don't get to see what they're planning. I don't want to wake up one morning and then realize that the road leading to the Rashtrapati Bhavan does not look the same anymore. Because you see, I've got memories, you know, as a kid, I visited there when my father has held my hand and pointed a finger and say, see, that's where the president of this country lives. You know, that's got 365 rooms. And one fine day I go there and I see, oh, the whole place has changed. And it looks like one of those extremely impersonal corporatized roads in Dubai, where both sides you only see glass buildings, which absolutely have zero character.
And now
I don't want to do that.
Also, when we talk about good design, the most basic thing for good design as a country that we need is good public toilets. I mean, good health and sanitation. Like I, you know, both of us love traveling in India to all these obscure offbeat villages, offbeat towns, random treks. You know, the biggest challenge is toilets.
Washroom. Yeah. Toilets. Oh my God.
Toilets. And toilet, I mean, we've figured a way around it, but I think a lot of people are deterrent to travel in India for the sole reason of toilets.
Yeah.
Okay. And this is travel is really a small thing, but I think for the people who live like everywhere, you know, the thing that they need on a daily basis, 10 times a day, is a good clean toilet. And that is one basic good design that we like need.
So basically you're saying that I should tell the government that the need of the hour is Sulabh Sochale.
Okay. Being half the diseases would stop right there, right?
And why should
but it that's be- why I think also that they started that as a movement, na? The
Sulabh Sochale.
But you know, as usual, the Sulabh Shauchalaya has got tagged as a dirty, stingy.
Because they don't want to maintain it. It's the same old story everywhere.
So why can't we make our toilets well? That's, I mean, it's quite a basic, like as if time is, you know.
Actually, you know what? I am going to simply define this whole situation with a very basic statement. It is not about the beautiful harmony that the or the synchronization that the architects can get with the with the government officials. It is not about how architects can add the value, because you see, obviously they can add the value. I mean, they are educated for it, they're trained for it, they're practicing for it. This is their bread and butter. Okay, there's no doubt about it. You know what we need foremost? Educated politicians. A politician who holds an education degree equivalent to a clerk in India, a basic graduation degree. Hamare aadhe politicians to paanchvi fail hai, pass bhi nahi hai, paanchvi fail hai. Unko apni signature aur anghoote ke alawa kuch samajh mein nahi aata aur bank mein kitne paise gaye hain. Okay, they only understand tenders.
We are still live or we've become censored?
We are live. We are live.
We've become censored now.
No, I have no problem.
Ranjita, this is the best of the worst mistake. That is, to me, when I was thinking of the best of the worst mistakes, I think that this whole discussion is about the best of the worst mistake that the government is like unable to connect with us as architects who are already. Unless Rishiji has a very interesting mistake. So going back to
Rishiji. I want to hear this.
I'll tell you one thing. जो भी वो नया पार्लियामेंट बिल्डिंग की जो बात आप लोग कर रहे हैं, जो कंपनी ने उसको लिया है प्रोजेक्ट को, वो सस्टेनेबिलिटी आर्किटेक्चर के बारे बहुत बात करते थे, अभी वो नहीं कर रहे उस बारे में, ठीक है? वो उसकी जो एशियंस है, दिल्ली के एशियंस को डिस्ट्रॉय कर रहे, उसकी भी बात नहीं कर रहे. दे आर हैप्पी टू गेट दैट प्रोजेक्ट एंड दे आर साउंडिंग लाइक हाँ यार वी आर चेंजिंग द लाइफ. We are changing life. और जब दूसरे जगह आते हैं तो they started pretending like we are the architects, we are doing this for this society. भाई तुम वहाँ से start करो ना, PM को तो समझाओ कि भैया ये चीज को ऐसा सुधारा जाए.
That is exactly what I'm coming to. So if you have even educated politicians, the essential is vision and will, not education. Vision and will.
And also honesty and you know what I'm saying. The
ये तो बाय डिफॉल्ट है.
नहीं नहीं, हम लोग पॉलिटिशियंस डिस्कस कर रहे थे. अंकुर ने जोक मारा.
मैंने
ब्यूटिफुल
एग्जाम्पल ऑफ विजन एंड विल.
It has not only put Dubai on global map, it has made Middle East a hot cake in this time purely because of vision and will.
Correct. Absolutely.
So in short, even if you have educated politicians and they lack vision and will, they're going to still in the same soup. So the point is, we need somebody who has a vision and will very clearly.
जिसके पास पार्टी के पास MLA नहीं है वो आपके CM बन जा रहे हैं. क्या बात करेंगे उसके बाद.
रुक जाएंगे
सर, अभी हफ्ते बाद. In short, good time for us architects to start campaigning for each other and start supporting each other and start participating in
you should come in the politic arena.
है ना, सोच रही हूँ अगले इलेक्शन में अपना नाम लिखवाती हूँ मैं.
We vote for Ranjita. हाँ.
Ranjita will hilau. She'll then, fire.
No, no. Then what will happen? Then what will happen? The speakers. डिक्शनरी लेके बैठना पड़ेगा टू टॉक टू
ऋषि सर. मैं आपसे ना अलग से मिलती हूँ डिक्शनरी लेके. बाय गॉड. अच्छा, वी आर मूविंग ऑन टू आवर नेक्स्ट पॉइंट. ओके, सो व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट ग्रेट डिजाइन, ओके, व्हाट आर योर पर्सनल ओपिनियंस ऑन यू नो द रेलेवेंस ऑफ प्रोडक्ट्स, द प्रोडक्ट्स दैट यू यूज, यू नो. अंकुर, शैल वी स्टार्ट विद यू?
यू वांट टू स्टार्ट विद समवन एल्स? आई जस्ट क्विकली.
ओके, आई विल स्टार्ट विद शिल्पा.
Ranjita, we have one and a half hour cross, huh?
I know, I told you. The conversations always get interesting, you know, eventually it gets interesting.
What was the question?
Already.
The relevant
tea break. I think we'll have to go to dinner break also.
Yeah.
No. Let us not get that idea. Especially since I've been exploiting my husband's culinary skills. Is he listening? No, he's not listening. Okay. So the relevance of great products for a great design. So when we look at products that we use, a lot of times, clients ko lagta hai ki overall project ki jo costing hai, agar products pe compromise kare, to costing kam ho sakti hai, thoda idhar udhar se let's cut corners. But I also feel kabhi-kabhi, great products actually encourage longevity. It encourages better living, sustainability of that entire project in terms of its physical form as well as the aesthetic value. I also feel that somewhere, एक वो छोटा सा corner हम नहीं cut करते हैं, तो better, it's more seamless, lifestyle that you derive from that place. So Shilpa, what do you think? The relevance of, come to you next.
Okay.
See, if you specifically talk about just products, you know, I think you end up kind of categorizing them for the requirement or the need. So you have products which are for safety, you know, which are like really important for the safety of the people living in that space. You have products which are there for comfort, you know, for the functionality purposes. And then you have products that are adding a layer of, you know, maybe the luxury, maybe a flair, you know, maybe additional requirements, whatever that is, and enhancing the whole space and sort of completing it. And then, of course, there is this whole line of products which adds the softer aspects to a project, like the emotional connect or like personalization, like we discussed, you know. So that entire circle is what the products is. And I think, you know, there can be a battle of products with every client, I guess, you know, and you have to sort of take your ground on certain things. But I think as an architect or as a designer, and I think as an architect practicing interior design also strongly, I feel that you never compromise on products for safety, ever.
Right.
So that's one thing that we believe very strongly, that, you know, you do not compromise on that. For example, a very small example of fire retardant paints. You know, we do antibacterial paints. We do, you know, everybody's doing zero paints, but you have this whole line of fire retardant paints, which a lot of clients are still resisting. You know, they feel like, oh, kya zarurat hai? What are the chances of getting a fire and, you know, this happening or that happening or this entire space? But we have sort of almost made it a requirement, and it just goes into the initial BOQ as a budget. Right. So we ask them to budget for it very initially, saying that, you know what, it is almost like saying that I am going to brush my teeth when I wake up in the morning. That's like your routine, and you don't eliminate that. You need to have that fire retardant paint, whether it's a commercial space, whether it's a residential space also. So it is, you know, looking at the cases that are happening, looking at the high rises that we are living in, you know, the systems that sometimes fail because we are relying on technology for everything now. Like, right. You know, so nothing can be a fail-proof system. Eventually, in these kind of situations, technology fails and you have to go back to your manual systems.
Right.
So these things are the only thing that can really take care of your safety, your life, and obviously the important things in your space. So right. I think, you know, that's one aspect that I'll touch upon. Of course, there'll be many others which I think everybody can pick up, of course.
So Shilpa feels that fire retardant paints are a way to go forward. How about you, Prashant? What do you say about this?
I would say that, yes, obviously, products really help you choose a lifestyle, basically. So as Shilpa very categorically broke it down into, you know, that this is your security, this is your comfort, this is your luxury, all of that. So very essentially, but say for example, basic product like a dishwasher, you know. So I'm sure everybody's realizing the value of a dishwasher in today's time when we don't have the maids coming in for. But we have done luxury homes where the client has refused to put a dishwasher purely because they have a full-time maid and they want to utilize them to the maximum. But a working woman in a budget project, for example, has said no, that I cannot spend so much of time on washing dishes, and if the maid doesn't come, I want a dishwasher as a backup. So, you know, it again defines your lifestyle, how you want to, like, for example, having a robot vacuum cleaner these days is a fantastic idea for working couples. I mean, they don't want to, you know, keep doing the mopping and keep doing the sweeping of floors and all of that. These robots really work wonders for them. So, you know, the product definitely carefully if chosen. It's not that, you know, whether if you just keep a coffee machine to yourself and you're sorted with your life because everything will be fine, you'll have to obviously learn to how to operate it. That is the second stage of investing in a product. But if you use it wisely, if you put your money in the right kind of a product, you can actually pass your way through these kind of times where you know exactly that what is your requirement, how you would want to have it. Even for example, say in a project where we have, in a residential project, we have taken up VRV just to save upon the outdoor space in the balconies, because balcony is a premium in that in a particular residence. And the client said that, oh, I would rather put one single outdoor machine and save a lot of balconies rather than putting individual outdoors and eating up all the balconies and killing all the balconies and making them non-usable. I would rather put it in a utility balcony and run a huge piping cost. But that is the lifestyle that he's chosen, because he chooses clearly that he wants to enjoy his balcony and not make every balcony a utility balcony by putting it the outdoor use. So basically, products define your lifestyle.
Yeah. Correct. Rishi sir, how do you feel about this? Aapko kaun se products?
Three categories. Pehli cheez hai safety, second cheez hai functional, aur third hai ki aap as a designer apni environment ke liye kya sochte hai. To mere liye first priority safety hoti hai, to main safety mein koi compromise karta nahi. So regarding wires, switches, and these are of the best quality. रही बात आपके फंक्शंस एंड हार्डवेयर्स की, हार्डवेयर्स में नो कॉम्प्रोमाइज. थर्ड आती है सोलर पैनल्स. आई यूज सोलर पैनल, सोलर गीजर, क्योंकि वो आपके एनर्जी सेव करती है. एनर्जी सेविंग कंपोनेंट्स भी होता है घर में. आप क्लाइंट को समझा सकते हैं कि जो आप पैसे हीटर गीजर उजर में यूज कर रहे हैं, यू कैन सेव लॉट ऑफ मनी एंड यू कैन हेल्प द एनवायरमेंट टू बी क्लीन.
तो ये सस्टेनेबल,
तो ये तीन चीज के लिए आई विल गो विद दिस.
वाओ रिचा, दैट इज वेरी शॉर्ट एंड शार्प बट सुपर स्वीट. एकदम बैंग ऑन टू द पॉइंट. एंड आई थिंक द सोलर पैनल आइडिया इज ब्रिलियंट. आई थिंक दिस इज समथिंग व्हिच इज वेरी अडैप्टेबल, यू नो, आई मीन कंसीडरिंग द फैक्ट दैट वी आर अ ट्रॉपिकल कंट्री, दिस इज वेरी डूएबल. व्हाट डू यू फील अंकुर, यू नो, व्हाट आर द प्राइमरी प्रोडक्ट सेक्शंस दैट यू फील, यू नो, ऐड अ लॉट ऑफ रेलेवेंस?
Even I, so definitely, I mean, I think each one has touched on all the points, and I also completely believe that safety, functionality, you know, all the aspects are extremely important, the way whether one uses paints, whether the way one specifies air conditioning or solar panels. Solar panels really more so when we are working on architectural projects of a larger scale. To be sustainable at an apartment level is also something. I mean, I'm just touching on a topic which is not additional. In terms of the use of fabric, the fact that it can be recyclable, I think we need to all come up with ideas of sustainability is now going to be the buzzword, because I think we all realize that the earth needs it. I think this entire situation that has arisen has given us a real jolt and the understanding that the earth is going to be able to handle that much only. Post that, it's going to you know, kind of give us signs, and then it'll give us an indication where we will need to be you know, taking a back foot. So I feel that using more sustainable materials in terms of furnishing, because we tend to change our furnishing every 2-3 years, or you know, it's like come Diwali, people want to change. So how can we give back to the earth? What are the other ways of using you know, in terms of recyclable materials, in terms of interiors or in the way you're building? How are we, even when we are doing projects, if we are able to source local materials which are around the project for the construction purpose, whether it's a, you know, if it's a laterite, or if we are building in some other place where you have you know, huge stone coming out from the entire structure. I remember we did we were trying to do a naturopathy center somewhere closer to Nasik side, and we literally explored the entire option of taking the earth and making building blocks with it. Yeah. You know, because we said we do earth rammed blocks. So we had to learn the technique and the machine from someone else, some other agency who makes it somewhere in the in Pondicherry side and way beyond there also. Then, you know, to really be able to educate the client, and I'm talking about this like 8-10 years ago. So at that point of time, for people to even relate to the fact that, you know, you can use the earth of the soil to make your own building blocks was, you know, why should we do this? And like how Shilpa said, you need to be educated. You know, you need to educate your client and you need to be patient about it. But yeah. To me, sustainability is something that will also be something of great importance, because I think we need to save the earth. It should not be that we are forced to take certain decisions which we would not later like and appreciate. And I think this one is like a complete jolt.
I agree with Ankur on the selection of materials in that aspect very strongly. You know, I think it's very important to, and now with this whole movement, I think the whole make in India, using Indian materials, getting your stuff made as locally as possible, you know, trying and sourcing everything that can be done in a certain radius, if possible. If I'm working on a project in Rajasthan, you know, it's best to get everything from there rather than, you know, taking stuff from Bombay and then using that entire load on the transport and everything there, adding to the cost also for that matter. Like right. we did this very, very different and interesting project called Rescue, which is basically, it's for Rescue, which is an animal rescue center in Pune. So it's an NGO, and we helped them build this outhouse. But obviously, being an NGO, there was no budget, and the entire project, right from the architecture, the doors, the window frames, the furniture, every piece that has gone into that space is either being donated, upcycled, recycled, bought from nearby, you know, just picked up from nearby places. So it's like this entire mishmash of all the space that, you know, all the things that were available. So it met both the requirements, you know, being eco-friendly, being sustainable, as well as obviously being able to meet that budget. And we could use all the local labors. So I think that becomes very important, to employ the local people to build those things.
Right, right. Thank you so much on that, Shilpa. That was very interesting to know all your opinions. I think this round can be called a tiebreaker between Ankur and Rishi sir, because I loved the entire solar panel aspect of it. I loved the recyclable and the product selection aspect that Ankur has brought to the front. And now moving on to the last two, but the most interesting factors. The best of the worst mistakes. प्रशांत के साथ शुरू करेंगे बेस्ट ऑफ द बेस्ट मिस्टेक।
पहले मुझे ये बताओ इसके हैम्पर में क्या क्या मिलेगा।
ले लो। बताती हूँ, वो सीक्रेट है। पहले
बेस्ट ऑफ द वर्स्ट मिस्टेक इज ऑलवेज नॉट हायरिंग एन आर्किटेक्ट एंड not living by their vision. Again, it comes to boils down to vision, because if you are constantly looking at Pinterest, constantly engaging into ki mere friend ke ghar pe ye hai, you know, I want to do this.
This is a serious problem.
I want to do this. That's pretty random, because the architect has bloody seen more 20,000 things better than that, and he's well exposed, well traveled. Please relate to that. Trust that architect, trust the designer, because you're putting in your money. So I personally feel your best or best of your worst mistake is always putting money on a doctor and not trusting the doctor to do the surgery and relying on Google ki abhi surgery mein aap ye wale stitches laga do.
ऋषि सर, आपका क्या ख्याल है, बेस्ट ऑफ द वर्स्ट मिस्टेक्स में आपको क्या लगता है?
नहीं, प्रशांत सर जो बोले वो सही बोले हैं कि नॉर्मली वो एक प्रोफेशनल को हायर करने के बाद उसकी बातें नहीं सुनना तो वो प्रॉब्लम आती है, लेकिन आपको चाहिए कि उनको समझाए, उनको एजुकेट करे उसके मामले में, और हम लोग ये काम करते हैं उसके बाद भी आप देखिए प्रोजेक्ट जब हम कंप्लीट करके जाते हैं तो वो वही कर देते हैं बाद में, आप उनके एक्सेसरीज को देखिएगा वो थोड़े दिन के बाद गायब हो जाएगी, आप कर्टेन का पैटर्न देखिएगा, आप एक पेंटिंग लगा के देखिए वहाँ पर उनको आप लगाएंगे एक कोई ब्यूटीफुल आर्टिफैक्ट और वो उधर पर ला के रख देंगे एक राधा कृष्णा की फोटो थोड़े दिन के बाद, राइट? तो ये आफ्टर प्रोजेक्ट कम्प्लीशन के बाद भी थोड़ा सा आपको ये मॉनिटरी करना पड़ता है कि वो कैसे उसको मेंटेन कर, दिस इज व्हाट आई थिंक बेस्ट ऑफ द वर्स्ट होता है कि कभी आपको प्रोजेक्ट को किसी को रेफरेंस करना जाए ना तो वो प्रॉब्लम आती है बाद में कि वो उस पैटर्न में नहीं रेडी रहता है जिस पैटर्न में आप बना के छोड़े।
बिल्कुल सर, आई थिंक इट्स अ वेरी रिलेटेबल प्रॉब्लम। शिल्पा, व्हाट डू यू थिंक?
यू नो, सो ऑफ कोर्स दे आर मेंशनिंग मिस्टेक्स इन वेरी जेनेरिक वेज एंड आई एम थिंकिंग ऑफ सम एग्जांपल्स दैट आर कमिंग टू माय हेड राइट नाउ, यू नो, व्हेन वी वुड विजिट। सॉरी,
वी वांट द स्पाइस।
हाँ, लाओ लाओ मसाला, मसाला के लिए अभी बनाने करते
हैं। You know, so when we were in the US, we would love visiting all these, you know, all the buildings and the structures that you've studied about in the books, you know, architectural magazines and everything. We had the chance to go see it ourselves in person, and we would try and do as much of that as possible, like taking road trips and everywhere. And you know, one of the spaces that I'm trying to remember is there's Walt Disney Concert Hall, which is done by Frank Gehry, okay?
Correct.
And it's a beautiful structure. It's amazing. We love Frank Gehry's work, actually. And so if you, you know, when it was done, it opened up huge and big and everything. And then slowly over time, what they started, you know, so it's basically for, if somebody in the viewer doesn't know, it's the facade is completely covered with stainless steel sheets. And really highly glossy sheets, you know, the entire facade. What happened is that over time, what they started noticing is that the entire area around started getting heated up more. The buildings nearby, the temperatures were increasing. There were these hot zones that were being created. And even drivers that were passing by, because of the reflected light,
they could feel the heat wave.
Yeah. No, they were actually, there were like accidents and stuff like that being spoken about. Now, you know, they figured out that it's because of the high reflectivity of the particular sheet. But if you really go back to both the points that Rishi Sir and Prashant were saying, that, you know, as an architect, he would have advised this. And so if, you know, you go and read, so when we went there, we were told the entire story that Frank Gehry had actually conceptualized that as a stone facade initially. But when the client had seen his recently done Guggenheim Bilbao Museum, he said, I want this over here. That's it, you know. And that was eventually what he was given, because they did not budge. And then this entire episode happened. And then they had to pump in, you know, millions to sort of reduce the glossiness of this thing, and, you know, so that they can fix it. So you know how sometimes the perception is so different, and you don't know where this really came from, where the story is. You know, it may come as an architect's thing, but it comes as a process of design, because when you may suggest something, but the client sometimes doesn't agree, you sort of have to say, okay, fine, I may need to still give you this. And eventually they realize, you know, they go back and they sort of say, okay, fine, this was, you know, what it was actually supposed to be. I should have listened. I should have trusted. And I'm talking about Frank Gehry here. So, I mean, we are meager architects.
No, I mean, I think I can completely see your point. It's not just a process of design. It's a process of learning. Yeah. In fact, when I looked up Bauhaus design concepts, you know, and I got to realize that, you know, in Germany, when they went from the steepled roofs to the flat bases, you know, that's how they introduced modern architecture and contemporary architecture, even in Hitler's time. You know, Hitler was initially all for it because he saw potential of his soldiers on those rooftops. You know, he saw potential of, you know, how he could actually keep every building under his constant monitoring, because, you know, building access was getting bigger, you know, better. And there were a lot of aspects. But eventually, in the long run, they realized that there were certain areas where you needed those steepled roofs, yeah? Because the snow was gathering on top of it, causing damp, leakage, and there were various other problems. You know, so when there were experts from the Bauhaus end of it who were actually coming and talking about these aspects or giving opinions, mm-hmm. he chose to listen, and then he just banished the entire situation, shut down the institute for a year. You know, just kind of, he did away with all their artifacts and everything. The institute restarted again, but could only survive for a year. So it was a very sad phenomena. You know, it actually shows lack of respect, lack of understanding. And eventually, you know, lack of a better thought process in terms of better society around you, you know, when you don't let an expert do their job. I think that is, Ankur, we are left with Ankur. Ankur, what do you think? What is the worst?
But you know, also that to demystify that, that's why they say that some of the international architects that we idolize are also someone, you know, sometimes they make huge mistakes or huge errors. And like Shilpa mentioned about Frank Gehry, even Santiago Calatrava, and you know, I just love his work, and I love the bridges that he makes and everything. And yes, he has been facing so much of flack, it's unbelievable because of the nature of work he's doing, and his cost overruns are tremendous.
I think the Dubai project is a live example of that.
Exactly, wherein you can kind of completely change the economy of a whole nation is the kind of cost overruns that they run. And I think that's when it kind of sets a bad name for the architect fraternity, because then people start feeling key when they take you on a project that you are going to increase the budget.
Yeah.
So they always try to say that, nay, we better be careful, right? They are always on guard in the beginning because they are weary that an architect has come means budget is going to go increase. So that is it. But also putting the foot in my mouth, I think one of the buildings, like taking from where you were speaking, Ranjita, about, you know, that Hitler's building was, you know, leaking and everything. I think, you know, one of these malls that I land up crossing several times is on Verli, the Atria Mall.
Yes, yes.
It's kind of, it is prime property. It is prime location. I don't know who... I don't know who's the architect. I'd probably be killed later. And I'm going closest to the city and obviously not claiming from outside some international designer, but I'm saying that, you know, the ability, the design, and we've seen literally a building fail, unfortunately, some of these malls.
I'll make it easy for you, Ankur, since, you know, you're trying to make the feedback polite. I'll make it easy. It's a disaster and a complete wastage of space. As a mall, it failed miserably. Miserably.
The best of the worst.
Yes. With extremely high CAM charges, which is common area maintenance charges, because of the amount of common area, which is literally competing with the utilized, you know, with the area that could be utilized as retail space, to a point where it is now being converted into a food hub.
It's a mini Kamla Mill now.
It's an amazing food hub. And what a food hub, and what food, and what restaurants, and what decor. I mean, I think
it's a massive leaking roof, and you know, actually, given that, you know, you're climatically, you are in a you know, in a city which has heavy rainfall, you have context to attend to. So I think that for us, it's like a learning thing, you know, because you want to do skylights, you want to do things, but unfortunately, we need lots more technique, we need lots more knowledge, ability to execute. You need much more better maintenance teams involved with it. Maybe, you know, your skill sets of detailing things have to be way higher and more superior. So, yes, unfortunately, I just, when you mentioned Hitler's thing, and I was like, this is a building you land up, you know, it's, for all of us, I think we cross it like several.
Yeah, they
I just said close to home. This was one of the glaring common public. You know, you kind of, when you just relate a small thing at a project or in a minor building, you sometimes cannot. Though internationally, you've heard of things fall, you know, building facade things fall off and stuff like that. So.
In fact, there is another thing about the Atria Mall which I want to tell you. I don't know if you've really observed it. So every time I go into town, okay, so parking is an issue. So what I do is I drive in, I go to the Atria Mall and I park my car. I think it's very convenient. Park your car, step out, take a cab and then go to whichever part of town. Simply come back to Atria, come back to the C-Link and you're back on the Western Express Highway, okay? Now, when you drive into the basement parking, okay, so there's this beam, okay, which projects down. So God help you if you're in a vehicle which is as high as a Fortuner or a Ford Endeavor, because trust me, you're going to graze the roof. So what should I do? Should I be like sticking to cars which are like half my height? Matlab itna hi hai. Matlab khade ho jaoge to aise, you know, you literally bend your head and make sure that either aapka sar phutega ya to gaadi ka chhat phutega, kuch to phutega. You know, it's like that. You know, so there are parts of the roof of the basement, and imagine it's a basement parking, okay? And I've seen people, you know, I've seen a Scorpio who's there, pushed past, and then I heard this very shrill banging kind of a noise, very weird noise. Then I realized it was your antenna ud gayi. That was the first time I realized what those beams were doing to your car. Because, you know, I just came to a halt behind him. I said, bhai, kya hua? Because he came to a screeching halt. And then he got done and he was checking. He realized his antenna is gone. That's your basement parking. So yes, the atrium all I completely agree. It's a disaster. Architecture is to pata nahi, but contractually jisne banaya hai, okay. Khatam kar diya.
No, but everything is designed, right, Ranjita? So you have to kind of attend to all these. Architecturally, also you have to attend to each and every small detail when you make it. You know, that's where the catch is.
नहीं बट वी हैव टू आल्सो टेक इनटू कंसीडरेशन कि भाई आर्किटेक्ट हैं आप बना रहे हो डिजाइन करके रेकमेंड कर रहे हो उसके पीछे आपका क्लाइंट बैठा है और दोनों के बीच में ना एक कॉन्ट्रैक्टर बैठा है और क्लाइंट को लगता है अरे आर्किटेक्ट ने बोला तो क्या है पहले कॉन्ट्रैक्टर से बात करता हूँ ना मे बी यू नो ही कैन डू सम मिरेकल Very gray area. Okay, so now we move on to the last aspect of this discussion because Prashant is looking so hungry. Usko dinner nahi milegi iske baad, you know.
Thank you.
No, I think Ranjita, seriously, everyone's giving us the looks. Everyone's like, and we're trying very hard to avoid all the conversation of the that it's time.
Yes.
No, I think
the last. Okay, oh. So in one word. Give me what's going to be what's your understanding of how design is going to be in the next decade. Give it to me in one word. So we'll start with Prashant.
Mindful.
I'm sorry, I didn't get that.
Mindful.
Okay, Ankur.
I've coined a new word: trans-co-lab. I'll explain later.
Okay, Rishi sir.
I don't have any words for next. So.
सर आप गाना गा के समझाओगे नहीं नहीं ओके ओके आप सोचो सर बिकॉज आई एम गोना कम बैक टू यू आर ऋषि सर आई एम गोना कम बैक टू यू मैं छोड़ूंगी नहीं इतना आसानी से शिल्पा गिव मी वन वर्ड फॉर व्हाट यू फील इज डिजाइन इन द नेक्स्ट डेकेड
ओके सो इट्स नॉट वन वर्ड इट्स हाइफनेटेड बट इट्स सो अनलर्न लर्न एंड रीलर्न आई थिंक दैट्स व्हाट वी ऑल नीड टू डू
ओके Rishi sir, coming back to you. Eight away loves.
From, away from books. Through be designs again, away from books. Not in a bookish language. Should okay. be something new.
Non-bookish.
Non-bookish yeah. language.
Okay. Okay. All right. Thank you. That is very interesting. This round goes to Prashant, though. I think I like the word mindful. I said yes. I think we have reached a stage jahan pe ab hame apne dimaag ka istamal puri tarike se karna chahiye. Completely. In all truth and honesty, like, you know, Ankur tells us, what joke wala tha. Okay. Agle discussion mein hum dekhenge, we are planning a discussion on the central vista. Aisa nahi hai ki hum controversial discussions nahi karenge. There are opportunities for you to join me on another platform that I, you know, work with Manish Dikshit, architect Manish Dikshit, jahan pe hume lagta hai ki hum naam leke gaali denge, bhai ki, tumne ye kya kiya? You know? So we actually tell people that this is what we think of you and this is what we feel you shouldn't have done or this is where we are going to slay you. But thank you so much for being on this platform and we've really run into almost 2 hours. Really run. But it was very, very interesting conversing with you. We have, we've had quite a bit of feedback from YouTube Live. I've got quite a few messages from Nishit actually in between. But thank you. Rishi sir, thank you so much. Non-bookish to main definitely yaad rakhungi. अगली बार हर एक बुक और मैगजीन पे मैं जो भी आर्टिकल पढ़ूंगी या कुछ भी मुझे ध्यान में आएगा मुझे आपका ये वर्ड नॉन बुकिश डिजाइन डेफिनेटली ध्यान में आएगा शिल्पा थैंक यू सो मच आई लव्ड योर पर्सपेक्टिव ऑन हाउ यू लुक एट हॉस्पिटैलिटी ऑन यू नो हाउ यू लुक एट डिजाइन एज अ बर्थ राइट अंकुर दैट कोट इज गोना स्टे विद मी लाइफ शुड बी बाय डिजाइन नॉट बाय डिफॉल्ट एंड ऋषि सर का रिसाइक्लेबल आइडिया इज ऑल्सो अमेजिंग एंड प्रशांत Thank you so much. You know, I think you have a very, very practical take on how you want your design to come across. I think that was very, very, you know, of high value to us and to our audience. Thank you, everyone. It's
Rita, could I just say that what I meant by that trans-co-lab, I was trying to say in one, two sentences. I was trying to say
that. Yeah, please.
Yes, please.
I feel that design is going to be transitional. It is only going to keep changing, right? So trans means transitional, change, constantly changing. Co, because we are suddenly in a co situation. Yeah, so pre-co, po-co, post-co. So, and also the fact that you collab, right? So, and lab really, because it's a laboratory. It's going to be a laboratory where you're going to be sustainable, you're going to be functional, you're going to be, you know, it's going to be a laboratory in where a lot of remix is going to happen. So hence trans collab was, I thought, let's be creative, like you say, live life by design. So I was coming up with, and design is my language. So I made a new word.
I totally love that. I think you've totally designed a beautiful word to depict everything that you're feeling at the moment as to how you feel the next 10, you know, the next decade is going to be about. I think
that's thank you for having us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
To everyone in the panel also, it was a lovely discussion.
Thank you.